If you're viewing this, you press the Help button under the Retention Methodology worksheet to learn more about how the BMP Trains model calculates dry retention requirements and efficiencies. First, we need to look at a few definitions and distinguish between retention and detention. The term retention is used to define stormwater practices which provide treatment by either percolation of the runoff into the ground or by evaporation. Now, for a retention system, there's no surface discharge for all inputs into the pond up to the treatment volume, and retention systems can result in a substantial reduction in the runoff volume discharged from the site. Detention systems, on the other hand, are stormwater practices where you detain the stormwater for a period of time before you release it. During that detention period, biological and chemical processes react on the stormwater and cause a reduction in concentrations so that the water that you release is lower in concentration than the runoff that came in. But there's generally little or no significant reduction in runoff volume associated with detention practices. This is a schematic of a dry retention pond, sometimes called infiltration ponds. They simply consist of an excavated pond into the ground with the bottom of the pond constructed a minimum distance of 3 feet above the seasonal high groundwater table. Now, in some cases, you'll see different minimum criteria specified. In some cases, you may see 1 foot above the seasonal high groundwater table. In other places, you may see 3 feet. But the bottom line is that the bottom has to be constructed above the seasonal high groundwater table. Runoff, which enters into the pond, infiltrates through the bottom such that the treatment volume is infiltrated into the ground within a specified period of time, generally 24 to 72 hours, depending upon the particular requirements. Now, typical design criteria for dry retention ponds would be providing retention for the first half inch of runoff, the first 1 inch of runoff, and in some cases, it's specified in terms of rainfall, where you would retain perhaps 1 inch of rainfall. Modeling of dry retention in the BMP Trains model uses an evaluation conducted by Harper and Baker in 2007 for FDEP, summarized in the document titled Evaluation of Current Stormwater Design Criteria Within the State of Florida. In this document, a model was developed to model the performance efficiency of dry retention practices throughout the state of Florida. A continuous simulation was conducted from a hypothetical 1 acre site using the SCS curve number methodology. And this analysis was performed for DCIA percentages ranging from 0 to 100 in 10 unit intervals, and non-DCIA curve numbers from 30 to 90 in 10 unit intervals. Now, the runoff was calculated based upon continuous hourly historical rainfall data collected at 45 hourly rainfall stations within the state of Florida, which generally had approximately 30 to 50 years of data per site. So a continuous simulation model was developed, which used the actual rainfall data as input for each of the 45 sites. When runoff enters the pond, it was assumed that 100% of the runoff volume for all rain events less than the treatment volume would be treated, and 100% of that runoff would be infiltrated into the ground. If the runoff volume from a rain event exceeded the treatment volume, then it is assumed that 100% of the volume is lost or infiltrated into the ground up to the treatment volume, and 0% removal is assumed for a runoff which bypasses the pond and goes to the point of discharge for the property. A hypothetical drawdown curve was also developed in case the pond wasn't completely emptied between rain events. So the drawdown curve was developed assuming a recovery of 50% of the treatment volume in 24 hours and 100% of the treatment volume in 72 hours. Each of these are common drawdown requirements used by water management districts within the state. The modeling also assumes that the runoff characteristics remain constant throughout the storm. In other words, no significant first flush effect is present within the watershed. Now, small watersheds may exhibit first flush effects, but the first flush effect becomes less significance, becomes of less significance in larger watersheds due to the large amount of contributing area. So the overall pond efficiency is calculated as the fraction of annual runoff volume infiltrated into the pond. Now, a series of tables were developed for retention efficiencies for each of the five meteorological zones in Florida in quarter-inch intervals from a quarter-inch to 4 inches. So there are 16 separate tables per zone, 80 tables total. And to estimate your removal efficiency for a particular retention depth, you would iterate the retention depth between tables that border the retention depths. In other words, if you were looking for the efficiency of a retention depth of 0.3 inches, you would iterate between the table for 0.25 inches and 0.5 inches, and also iterate between different values of DCIA and non-DCIA curve number. Fortunately, the BMP Trains model does these iterations for you. When we conducted this modeling, though, we found some interesting results. We found that the efficiency of dry retention varies significantly throughout the state of Florida, depending upon location. For example, if you have a project which is 40% DCIA and a non-DCIA curve number of 70, and you provide half inch of treatment, a half inch of runoff as detention treatment, in zone 1, that would result in an annual removal efficiency of about 58%. Zone 1 is in the Pensacola-Tallahassee area, where they have a large number of larger storm events that would exceed the capacity of the system, and water would bypass the pond untreated. If you're in zone 2, though, that same pond, same physical characteristics, would result in a removal efficiency of about 70% because there are fewer rain events in zone 2, which would bypass the pond. Similarly, in zone 3, 4, and 5, we have differences in retention efficiency because of differences in rainfall characteristics. The blue lines on here represent treatment efficiencies for systems designed to provide retention for the runoff from 1 inch of rainfall. Notice that several things. One, the retention efficiency of these vary between the different zones. And second, that providing retention for 1 inch of runoff is generally less effective than providing retention for a half inch of runoff. Another conclusion that you can make from looking at this graph is that the current dry retention design criteria in most cases fail to meet the 80% design standard outlined in state water policy for stormwater management systems. Another way of looking at this, let's look at separate projects constructed in Melbourne and Pensacola. Let's say we have a project which is 80% DCIA and a non-DCIA curve number of 70. In Melbourne, to achieve 80% removal, you would need a retention depth of about 1 inch of runoff. However, for the same project in Pensacola, since they have a larger percentage of large rain events, which can potentially bypass the system, your retention depth to achieve 80% removal increases to about 1.4 inches because of differences in rainfall characteristics. To achieve 95% removal on a statewide average, which is sometimes necessary in pre versus post analyses, especially for parameters like phosphorus, you would need a retention depth somewhere around 2.75 inches on a statewide basis. That depth would be larger in the panhandle and lower in central and southern portions of the state. The BMP trains model, as I said previously, takes all the tabular efficiency relationships that were developed by Harper and Baker and located in Appendix D of the 2007 report and conducts these iterations for you based upon your rainfall meteorological zone, your annual rainfall depth that you obtain from the isopleth maps, your project DCIA, your non-DCIA curve number, and either a retention depth or a desired efficiency. And the BMP trains model iterates and gives you the results. Now let's look at an example problem. Let's say that we have a hypothetical project in Pensacola, Orlando, and Key West, the same project, and we have pre and post loadings for nitrogen and phosphorus for this project. The required nitrogen efficiencies range from 63 to 68%, with phosphorus removals ranging from about 88 to 90%. Now, since retention is based upon infiltration of water, the removal efficiency for nitrogen and phosphorus will be the same. So the design is based upon the most restrictive removal efficiencies, which in this case occur with phosphorus. So the system will be designed to remove anywhere from 88 to 90% of the annual runoff volume, which will provide the needed load reduction for total phosphorus as well as total nitrogen. All right, so let's say we have a project with 18.75% DCIA, a non-DCIA curve number of 81.4, and from Appendix D in Zone 1, which is Pensacola, we need a removal of 89% because 89% was the largest of the two when you look at nitrogen and phosphorus. That would be a dry retention depth somewhere between 2.25 and 2.5 inches. Now, if you're doing this manually, you would have to go to the 2.25 inch table, iterate between DCIA percentages of 10 and 20, and then for non-DCIA curve numbers between 80 and 90, and you'd come up with an efficiency of 87.8%. Well, that's less than 89, so that's not enough. If you go to 2.5 inches, you would have to iterate between DCIA percentages of 10 and 20, and again, non-DCIA curve numbers between 80 and 90, come up with an 89.6%, which is too much. Then you have to iterate between these to find the desired retention depth of 2.42 inches to achieve 89% removal. And as I said previously, the BMP trains model does all of these iterations and calculations for you. So in summary, The efficiencies of retention systems vary substantially throughout the state of Florida due to variability in meteorological characteristics. The BMP trains model calculates these efficiencies based on the hydrologic characteristics of the project, the physical location within the state, and the annual rainfall, and provides either an estimate of the efficiency or the retention depth required to achieve the desired efficiency.